from CNN in Espanol, and I'm very happy to have a very relevant conversation nowadays on how Latin America can increase and improve its business environment to attract more foreign and local investment. Just a couple of comments on housekeeping, please. If you can silence all your electronic devices, we would appreciate it. This session also is live stream on Facebook. I always forget the word. This session is live stream on Facebook. We're also going to open the session to your questions 20 minutes prior to the end. And I will also ask you to have your headsets ready because we're going to be doing this session in English. Your headsets are over there. And if you have a question in Spanish, just beware that some of our speakers need to take the time to put the headphones on. Without further ado, we all know that Latin America needs capital to supplement its low, very low domestic savings in many cases, finance new industries, enhance existing ones, boosting infrastructure, productivity, and employment in the process. I have a fantastic panel to answer some of these questions and make this a productive conversation. I want to thank Ricardo Hausmann, in the corner, director of the Center for International Development, professor of economic development at the Kennedy School of Government in Harvard University. As he says, former, a lot of things, planning minister in Venezuela, member of the board at the Central Bank in Venezuela. Welcome. Thank you. Luis Alberto Moreno, president of the Inter-American Development Bank, as you know, a main source of multilateral financing for economic, social, and institutional development in the region. A decade already, Luis Alberto, at the IADV. Also, thank you, Douglas Peterson, President and Chief Executive Officer of Standard & Poor's Global. Its divisions include S&P Global Ratings, S&P Global Market Intelligence, Dow Jones Indices, and Global Platts. Peterson was with Citigroup for 26 years. Prior roles include Citigroup Japan and Country Manager for Costa Rica and Uruguay, so you know the region. Welcome. Claudia Dill, Chief Executive Officer for Latin America at Zurich Insurance Group, with more than 25 years of experience in the banking and insurance sector. She joined Zurich Insurance Group in 1999, appointed CEO for Latin America in 2016. She has lived in four continents, by the way, Claudia, so you can bring us a lot of the perspective and how you see the region with fresh eyes. She's based in Sao Paulo. And last but not least, Pablo Goldberg, Portfolio Manager on Emerging Market Debt, BlackRock USA. The world's largest asset manager, yes, I have to say. Pablo's responsibilities include, amongst many, formulating developing investment strategies. Welcome to you all. And let me start with one question. Give me one solution on how can Latin America boost its economic growth through changes and adjustments in its business environment. What needs to be done? I know the list is very long, but a short list would be Ricardo.
Well, I think that if you say one thing, it is the capacity to sit down and identify what needs to be fixed. And that's going to be very different from country to country, from industry to industry. But what you saw the president of Argentina say in the plenary session, he said that he's creating these dialogue mechanisms so that issues can be put on the table and discussed. And the issue is not how can we make foreign capital more profitable. The issue is how can we raise our productivity. We need to have the discussion in terms of how can society progress and how can cooperation lead to the progress of society. And that agenda is going to kick out, you know, a to-do list. The to-do list has to come from a process that is perceived as socially legitimate.
Thank you. Doug, you want to say something?
No, I just think, simply to add to what Ricardo was saying, the fundamental issue is how do you create this public-private dialogue? But more importantly, we're not alone in this world of attracting investment. There's a lot of other countries trying to do the exact same thing. And let me just give you a fact. While you have you know, the structural reforms that basically lead to the growth in productivity, among others. We're doing, on average, in countries, two or three structural reforms. They're tough to do. But the average for other parts of the world is about 15. And so the question is exactly what Ricardo was saying, but getting the kind of political coalitions that can lead to advance precisely in this area.
Douglas, one of the things that President Macri also mentioned was predictability to increase trust. How is Latin America becoming more predictable, less predictable?
Well, first of all, predictability is one of those factors which will attract investors, will attract people to the region. And is Latin America getting more or less predictable? It depends on what we talk about, because you have Venezuela, which is in a situation that's getting less predictable, and you have Argentina, which under Macri is getting more and more predictable all the time with the foundation of all of the reforms that he's been making. As a region, with Brazil improving, in a sense the political environment's going through, with Argentina improving, with Mexico and the US being maybe a little bit less predictable right now, but some of the recent changes that took place with the energy sector opening up, I think we're seeing a more predictable environment from my point of view.
A more predictable
more
environment.
More predictable.
One of the things that Claudia can tell us with fresh eyes, you live in Brazil, and there's an important factor that people sometimes overlook, and that's talent. In the age where people are talking about talentism as the new capital, how is Latin America getting ready not only to develop new talent through educational reform, but also bring in new talent?
Yeah, so talent is a key factor in Latin America next to the environment that needs to provide a productive environment for this talent to work in. We have a lot of young, high potential talent that needs more and further education, not just by schooling, but actually on the job in the companies. So we really need to develop trainings on the job to make them more effective in an environment, in a corporate environment. However, what is missing to a certain degree or is very scarce is more experienced talent in certain expertise areas in particular. And there we have been working on multiple different ways to try to find that talent, either actually try to attract Latin American people who left Latin America and try to bring them back in a more predictable environment, maybe more attractive to bring them back into the region. We also brought foreigners in to help to accelerate development of younger talent, but it's not a sustainable solution. We really need local talent in the end to move us forward. So we try to go on multiple different routes, and I think everybody needs to do that. The state has to come up with better educational systems, but the private companies have to come up with different systems as well in order to develop the entrepreneurial and also more corporate culture that is required and understanding.
You touched on this subject, Ricardo, earlier today, talent and how Latin America is in stark. It's a failing bringing good talent, and we're criticizing a lot our neighbor in the White House, Donald Trump, those policies, while at the same time we're not acknowledging that we do not appreciate foreign talent. What else can you add from what you said this morning?
Well, I think, you know, Latin America, always, you know, everywhere you go, the people complain about skills shortages here and there, and they always immediately say from skills shortages, education or education and training. But the truth is that, you know, the way the world tends to solve skill shortages is also through migration. And in that sense, Latin America has been surprisingly closed. That was not our history in the beginning of the 20th century, but we became increasingly closed. And the numbers are super stark. We don't realize how close we are until we start looking outside of our region. So, for example, everybody wants to emulate Singapore. Singapore is 40% foreign. Everybody, you know, in Chile, they like to compare themselves with Canada, Australia. Australia is 27% foreign. Canada is 25% foreign. The U.S. is 14% foreign. In the U.S., 30% of entrepreneurs are foreign. And at Harvard, I can document that over half of the professors are foreign. Thank God. And in Latin America, the numbers are amazing. You have Chile, which is not yet at 2% foreign, rising, and there's already some social reaction. You have a Mexico that is 0.4% foreign. That means one out of 250 people are foreigners. And in Colombia, it's one in 400. So, you know, it's very, very hard to create, you know, world-class institutions, world-class companies, world-class anything, and to be able to absorb, innovate, and so on, by relying exclusively on U.S., on locally born talent. If it was based on locally born talent, Silicon Valley would not exist. So we are making it in unnecessarily difficult on ourselves. We want to do, to grow, to diversify, to innovate, while doing it only with locally born talent. And you know, the world has not found a way to do it that way.
Douglas, you
want to say? Yeah, I want to add something to that. One of the most important topics for the countries in Latin America is to diversify their economies away from commodity dependence. And some of those ways to do it are through value-added services, even in the commodities themselves, adding to the value in the value chain. It's also new manufacturing and, very importantly, services. This global services economy, whether it's the kind of people that we have up here, which are in the intellectual property industries, or it's other types of technology, those require an investment in social infrastructure, as I call it, in education and healthcare. And we heard about the quality of the talent and how important it is. But it's also an imperative to diversify the economies and get into the growth cycle of the global economy.
Pablo, how do you see it when you look at emerging markets and you see this challenge from Latin America? How do foreign investors look at the region nowadays?
I think this has to do with the first question you ask. That is, the question is, what is one of the most important things that you need to get? Thank you. That you need to get for the region to take it to the next phase. And Ricardo was talking about, you know, getting together and deciding collectively what we want to do, what we want to achieve. And I think the next step is how we want to achieve it. And there I want to bring it to the issue of institutions. I think investment in sustainable and through time institutions are extremely important for Latin America and extremely important to solidify the way that foreign investors approach the region. One of the things that you point out is the need to get long-term funding for long-term projects in a region that is particularly low in savings. So the duration of those, of that lending, needs to go together with the duration of the project that it's going to try to finance. And you were talking about infrastructure earlier. But also, you need to create an business environment that stays somewhat similar for that period of time. And that is what institution brings. Because when you look at which are those strong democracies are those where you have alternance of power, different parties at a different time. But the institutions remains the same. The judiciary and the laws stay over time. You know, the objectives of the central bank stay over time. The way they handle the public monies stay over time. Without institutions staying for a longer period of time, it's very, very difficult that the region will attract the long-term investment needed for the long-term development.
On the topic of institutions, Luis Alberto, how has the IADB helped improve transparency, strengthen institutions?
Well, look, first of all, the reality is that there is no quality development in any country if you have weak institutions. So building up institutions is not by decree, but on the contrary, is basically around how you populate those institutions, the quality of people that you're able to attract, how they can work together, and more importantly, how you begin to develop the set of regulations that allow institutions to really be important in regulating markets and in supporting development. You mentioned corruption. Certainly this is the one issue that is in the minds of many people in Latin America, and I don't know if we have problems of corruption today that are worse than before. But I can say this. We are largely today, by definition, a middle-income region. At least 50% of Latin Americans earn more than $10 a day, and that's basically the economic definition of middle income. It is not that people who are in the middle classes have changed their consumption habits, but they equally have acquired middle class values. And when people acquire middle class values, they demand more transparency, they demand a set of public services that are not simply giving you the basic coverage, but on the contrary, they want better quality and they want it now. And if you look at some of the polls, the Latin Barometer poll that is typically done every year, most people are not reacting to their economic situation, as they are rather reacting about issues of security. I'm talking here citizen security, and I'm equally talking about questions of corruption, for one. We supported the government of Chile, which President Bachelet led an effort that brought together all of the political factions of Chile to approve a law that is called the Law of Probity and Transparency. And there is a combination of laws that begin with campaign finance, which basically states that campaign finance should be led by government support. It equally dwelled into the responsibilities of the private sector, and certainly the ways how you can correct problems when the private sector enters into these kinds of situations where there is abuse. And on the whole space of institutions, it's probably our largest practice in terms of what we do at the bank. Ricardo has many titles. The one that he's most famous for was being chief economist at the IDB.
Yes.
And he knows there, I mean, we did a lot of work in these areas and continue to do a lot of work because I think it's the central most important work of what we do.
Thank you. You touched on two topics, one of them corruption. Let me address a little bit of that. I searched a number of reports to just, as a way of context, tell you, you know, what the feel is nowadays. So I found a recent CFO survey from Duke University that says optimism rebounded from last quarter historic low. This is in regards to Odebrecht. The depth and breadth of that scandal, over $800 million, 15 years, bribes, 12 countries involved. I mean, we can never overstate on what is, you know, the dimension of this scandal. Interestingly enough, Pablo, in the year of this scandal, only 15% of firms operating in Peru, for example, and Brazil, and you know in Peru, Odebrecht was kicked out, said they reduced planned investment spending this year, which is interesting when you try to figure out how things are going to change and how Odebrecht is changing. Talking about corruption and state-owned enterprises, Ricardo, what can we learn from countries that are in the extreme cases like Venezuela, state-owned entities like PDVSA, for example, that are important to look at as lessons?
Well, I think that I would like to separate two problems. One problem is when, you know, the state becomes controlled by criminals. And then, you know, all bets are off because, you know, when the state is controlled by criminals, they use the state for their own purpose and so on. And that's different from the problem of corruption that you find in government functions. So, first, I think that when we talk about corruption, we should all acknowledge the incredible contribution that the Brazilian judicial system is doing for transparency in Latin America. Because if it weren't for the district attorneys of Brazil, you know, this would be going on. And you know, we know about Odebrecht, we don't know about everybody else. And this is so, like, we think about, you know, countries should reduce corruption in order to encourage foreign investment. This is sort of like foreign investment induced corruption, which is the opposite logic. But what I think is critical for an organization is to be able to perform its functions, its capacity. So if you think about the government, the key problem is state capacity. Is the state able to do what it needs to do? Can it assure security? Can it educate its people? Can it run a health system and so on? And if it is low in capacity, it will be low, among other things, in its capacity to prevent theft from its own agents, to prevent hanky-panky in its procurement and so on. It's one symptom or one more symptom of lack of state capacity. So in PDVSA in particular, the government thought that political control of the company was the fundamental thing. So they decided to fire 300,000 years of professional experience in the industry in 2003 and substituted with party loyalists. So since then, production has collapsed, investment has collapsed, efficiency has collapsed, and on top of that, they've stolen a ton of money. But if you just prevent theft, you don't solve the problem, because the problem is that in order to run these companies, you need know-how. And if in know-how is not something you can expropriate, it's not something, you either have it or you don't have it. And you kicked it out, you lost managerial capacity, that led to operational disaster and to massive corruption. But don't think that attacking just corruption is the solution. The solution is to build up the capacity that includes the capacity to control corruption.
Anybody wants to add anything? I wanted to also incorporate another report. It's important to give some research to back these opinions, especially where you're in the media nowadays. Natural Resource Governance Institute states that on a report presented at the OECD meeting last week, precisely on corruption and integrity, precisely that state-owned companies are a major nexus of corruption. So when you talk about perceived risk, has it changed when it comes to state-owned enterprises? What do you say?
I think that there's a confusion there about what is the role of the public sector. There's a confusion where what is big state and what is a strong state, and they're confused to be the same thing, and they're not the same thing. A strong state is a state that can have the right rules on property rights, the right rules on defining disputes among privates, like a strong judiciary. It could be a state that can do transfers between the wealthy and the poor, but that doesn't have to be a big state that has to probably apply a consumer rights appropriately against big corporations. That is a strong state that is not a big state. And I think in Latin America there's always that confusion. Yeah. And when people say, okay, we're going to reduce the size of the state because we cannot finance a deficit that is taking us into recession and to a bad problem, oh, the reason is, oh, you don't want the role of the private sector. Yes, you can have a strong role of the public sector without having a big public sector. You need to have the right laws and the right enforcement of the roles of the public sector. That I think is very much what Ricardo was talking about.
Douglas.
One of the areas that I would follow up on from the discussions about attractiveness investment, anywhere you go in the globe right now, even in the United States, infrastructure is one of the biggest themes for development and for growth. Countries that either have an infrastructure deficit because they've never invested, or countries like the United States that have gotten way behind. In order to have an infrastructure program in which we'll make an area like Latin America more attractive, the public sector today controls most of it, whether it's the ports, the airports, the highways, the pipelines, the electric systems. And this, going back to your question about corruption or the quality of transparency and governance in this sector, is absolutely critical, especially when so many countries at the same time are undertaking massive infrastructure projects. If you want to be able to attract the top global construction firms, project firms, financial institutions, they're going to be required, because most of the countries don't have the capital to do these programs just domestically, you're going to have to eliminate this corruption from the system.
Standard & Poor's recently put out a report on some of the risks perceived in Latin America. Can you name them? And one of them is political risk.
Yeah, so in obviously in Latin America, we do reports, and political risk is one of those at the top. And I'll use going back to my theme on infrastructure again. One of the issues, this political uncertainty that could come up, is if you do a large contract to build a power plant or a system, and you've got a private sector involvement in it, but then the government turns around and changes the rules of the game 3 or 5 years later. This is one of those types of political risks. But the types of risk that we look at political risk, we look at also domestic quality of the institutions, we look at transparency, we look at the quality of the domestic capital markets, and then we're also looking at other factors which are more traditional macroeconomic factors: growth, inflation, exchange rate convertibility, the quality of the banking system, et cetera. Those are the broader factors that we look at when we're analyzing investment and risk in Latin America.
Anybody wants to say perceived risk for you, Pablo, for companies looking long-term into the region right now?
I think political risk is very important. If we just look just this weekend, right? Everything that happened this last few days, right? You got the firing of the Ministry of Finance in South Africa that led to S&P putting South Africans sub investment grade. You get the contested elections in Ecuador. You got, you know, the 360 movement of the Supreme Constitutional Court in Venezuela about the role of the assembly. You get the demonstrations here in Buenos Aires last Saturday in support of the government. So these political risks are very important when you're thinking about investing in the region. I'm talking about emerging markets. In general, Latin America is very, very particular. Countries that become more predictable are countries that are going to see longer-term financing at lower rates and going to generate more growth. And probably it's going to be the countries that are going to also be attracting most of the good talent.
Can I follow up on
that
one second? Because one of the cycles of dependency, so to speak, in the political risk is also when you get into a situation where the political risk is so high, whether it's through corruption or subsidies. In a case like Argentina, you ended up with a hyperinflation, which then turns into political risk and social risk. You have a hyperinflation, you can't keep up the payments or increases that people expect in their wages. It creates an expectation from the population that they're falling behind or they're actually not able to even pay their rent and buy food because the inflation is so high. But what was the cause of the inflation? There's all these factors at the end of the day end up being interconnected.
Thank you. One of the other things that Luis Alberto mentioned earlier had to do with institutions and expectations from the people. I was wondering how important has it become for predictability, the managing of expectations, communicating so the companies can operate and people can live, you know, in less unstable economies, communicating a path from governments into the private sector. How much has managing expectations in countries that have, you know, governments that have won elections by only very narrow margins, how has that become increasingly important and governments reacting to that same as the private sector? What would you say?
Well, first of all, it is not unusual to find more and more elections to be won by small margins. I think that's largely a phenomenon of the world. It has to do with deep-seated divisions across political parties and ways that societies look at the direction a country needs to take. Having said that, the art of governing is precisely trying to find a consensus in the differences and trying to move agendas forward. The other thing is that we underestimate, you know, what's very interesting in Latin America is the profusion of social media and the connectivity that today exists across Latin Americans. In a country like Brazil, the average Brazilian spends more time using social media than the average American in the United States. The numbers of cell phone penetration, and especially smartphones, is growing significantly. We have something like 110% of cell phone penetration, but we're now about 50% of smartphones. And I don't have to tell you, look at the numbers of people on Twitter. We know everybody talks about the tweets of President Trump. But you go across Latin America and look at the Twitter feeds of heads of state are some of the largest in terms of subscribers. That tells you something about the evolution of society. It has to do with the fact that we still have a demographic bonus. The average age of Latin Americans is 27. But certainly, the sense of disclosure and openness of government is something not only people claim, but I think it's a path towards precisely getting the kinds of transparency and, as a result, a beginning of management of expectations that can be used through this media.
Let's go to rewriting or rules being rewritten outside in the world. As you know, today, President Trump and President Xi Jinping are meeting in what some people call the Winter White House, you know, Mar-a-Lago, Florida, and whatever they decide is critical for our countries in Latin America. Having said that, do you think companies need to prepare to do business in a world that is deglobalizing, their investment decisions go accordingly? What is your assessment so far of what's happening?
I'll start. First of all, you have to learn how to play golf. This is now a very important skill with Mar-a-Lago being the winter White House. But more seriously, I take a view, and this is what we see in terms of capital flows and flows of goods and service, despite some of the nationalistic tendencies and populist tendencies that we've seen crop up in different elections, and even despite Brexit, the world is globalized. It's not going to be very difficult to go backwards, partially because of what Luis Alberto said about social media. Social media does not have borders. That doesn't mean that somebody doesn't just watch what they want to watch, but social media is borderless, as well as goods and services are now becoming more and more borderless. If you look at the supply chain of automobiles now, their parts coming from Japan and Korea and Germany and Austria and Czech Republic, going to Mexico, back and forth between the United States before an assembled car is delivered in the United States. You're not going to go backwards on that. This is something that, despite some of the current political tendencies, it's going to be very hard to deglobalize.
Please?
No, I mean, a couple of things on this. I think the world will continue. Yes, there are clearly winds of protectionism in the industrialized world today. But let me give you an example. Doug was in our annual meeting last week in Paraguay. We produced a report that basically says that without any additional trade agreements, Latin America could benefit by doing a couple of things. First of all, by converging the rules of origin of all our trade agreements. Rules of origin basically determine how a product is considered made in Argentina or made in Brazil, and those rules change from country to country. Mm-hmm. So the convergence of those rules allows to something that Ricardo has written a lot and studied a lot, which is basically how you begin to develop value chains, which we live in a world like Douglas was saying before, where it's not that you produce the entirety of a product in a country, but rather on the supply chains. There's other areas like agreements that have not been met. We have this today and tomorrow, as President Macri was saying earlier, a meeting to try to converge the so-called Alliance of the Pacific with Mercosur. This would be huge. The other part is, even though you can have all the right trade agreements, you still have what we call a software of trade that has not been sufficiently developed. And that is, you know, the time it takes to bring export or import products in a border of a country. And there, what we have been doing is what we call single windows, that in essence, they converge all of the different entities that a government puts in place, the customs, the phytosanitary, et cetera, put that all into electronic information, and that way it accelerates the trade. We're now looking to see, for instance, in the Alliance of the Pacific countries, how those electronic windows talk to each other. And we're doing that equally between Argentina and Brazil. Doing things like determining which is the single, there's companies that trade a lot, understanding those companies and how they, as a result of being known by two sides of the export equation, can have, in essence, a fast track. These kinds of things, without doing additional trade agreements, would go a very long way. We equally put in this report, for instance, where there is no trade agreements between, say, Brazil and Mexico, which would really create a big space. So in sum, yes, the world can change, but I think we nobody can stop, and I think this is the real opportunity, in my view, for Latin America.
Thank you, Ricardo.
Well, two things. First, I'm not comfortable in predicting that the U.S. is going on a protectionist bend. I know that Trump has said a bunch of things, and we know that he says whatever. He's unpredictable, so, you know, it was obvious that he was going to repeal and replace Obamacare. Now it's not obvious that he's going to repeal. There are many areas in which it's just too soon to tell which direction it's going. I don't see a political grounding in the U.S. for a protectionist policy. That is, he doesn't have the votes in the Republican Party. I don't see that he has the willingness on the Democratic Party, etc. So he can use his presidential authority to stop deals, but I don't think he can undermine the rules. I don't think that the votes are there for a change in that direction. But more importantly, I think that Latin America has done enormous progress in trade policy. And compared to the progress in productive development policies. So, you know, we've opened up markets. Say, Colombia has opened up the U.S. market, has a free trade agreement with the U.S. What has happened to Colombia's exports to the U.S.? Nothing. So, essentially, you know, while, you know, Mexico in the first 10 years of NAFTA, so like quintupled its exports to the U.S., you know, in the first X years of Colombia, nothing is happening. And that's not because they faced high tariff or trade barriers. It's because they don't have the supply capacity. So that's why we need to focus the region on developing our capabilities, developing our productive capabilities, moving into new industries, moving into new areas, figuring out how to involve the companies that have the know-how, the capacity to get us into those areas, and have the productive dialogue that we need to make these things happen. I'd say that that area is much more important than, for example, there's, I don't know what percentage, but something like 30% of the exports of Mexico to the U.S. are down outside of NAFTA. Because, the, you know, if you go through NAFTA, you pay zero. If you go outside of NAFTA, you pay 3%. But if going through NAFTA is too complicated, you might as well pay your 3%. So it's not that if NAFTA is, you know, changed, you know, costs are going to differ that much compared to the amount that the peso depreciated after Trump won the election. So I think that the fundamental driver for us is still to worry about our productive development policies, and I don't think that these trade margins are big enough to make a difference.
But then isn't it the perfect time to improve and reduce the cost of doing business? And by that I mean, for example, just citing the World Bank doing business, paying taxes is complex in Latin America. The cost is still an issue. For Argentina, it's still one of the main deterrents when it comes to bringing more investment, when we're talking about boosting investment, boosting economic growth. Pablo?
I think that there's something quite ironic about globalization and this meeting that Trump is having with Xi Jinping. It is very interesting because the idea of globalization was something that started in the developed markets. It didn't start in the emerging market. I mean, the developed markets were trying to push emerging market to open up to the rest of the world. And it is very interesting that this anti-globalization move now with Brexit and some of the vote in the Rust Belt states for Trump is trying to say, well, this has not worked for us. This has not worked for the developed markets. But for the emerging markets, particularly for Latin America, this has worked very, very well. I mean, the millions of Brazilians that move from poverty to the middle class, the millions of Peruvians that move from steam poverty up in the world chain is significant. So it is not surprising now that you have China being kind of the spokesperson for free trade. And on the other hand, you have some of the, at least Trump, whether he will continue or not with this, trying to talk about some globalization, anti-globalization issues. I think that this is very ironic, and I think that this is not possible to go back in the globalization path. Now, with taxes, it's a very important part of the story, because one of the things that Latin America has always been dealing with is very low tax compliance, and at the same time, significant poor provision of public services. And that they do go together. The fact that people believe that their taxes are not worth what they pay because they don't see anything back. People have to have their kids sent to private school, have a private medical insurance. I think that's going back to the idea of development, institutions, corruption, really make the people feel that worth that paying their taxes makes something. And that is actually joint work between the public sector and the private sector.
Anybody else? Douglas? No? Yeah, please, Claudia.
So the point is also the role of society, the role of the people. We talk a lot about the state, the government. We talk a lot about private corporations and their role. What is the role of society? I mean, in Brazil, people for a long time have accepted corruption. People today in Brazil don't accept it anymore. They want this to be changed. So in the end, governments, private corporations, and civil society people, all of them have to push in the same direction. And when we talk about the complexities of changing Latin America, if actually society is changing and putting a different type of pressure on the companies, on the governments, there will be a different time of momentum that can be built for change.
Thank you. I'm going to open the session to some questions. I don't see the microphone, but I'll, if somebody please has a question, just raise your hand and just try to make it brief so we have time for... No questions? Ah. I can go on. Go ahead.
Thank you very much. Bertrand Badré, I was managing director of the World Bank until last year, and I'm now creating a company to invest in sustainable development in Latin America. I think that's one of the themes that was mentioned at the very beginning, but I think as part of the underlying trends, there is not only Trump and all these things, but you still have a very peculiar interest rate environment in the world, and you also have a growing interest for sustainable investment. So it's still minority, but it's growing. So I do believe that Latin America has a potential to be one of the areas in the world where these things can materialize, where the interest of investors can materialize, provided we create the real ecosystem there. I think we have everybody on stage. I mean, the development banks, the ratings, the insurers, the institutional investors. How can we move to the next stage? Thank you.
Well, I would say that, you know, how to move to the next stage. I think it's very important for emerging markets in Latin America in particular, not to waste this opportunity that we have right now. Some countries, not all, have wasted the years of the commodity super cycle. Some countries have invested very well. Take Peru for one case, to really, really do well and generate a very solid development structure with commodity prices. But now that is gone, right? I mean, countries have adjusted to new level commodity prices, some better than others. But then we have this period of still lingering low interest rates. And this means that there's a significant amount of capital looking at the emerging markets for interesting projects, interesting ideas. I think that we have said a lot about how not to waste this opportunity, right? Creation of institutions, cleaning of the judiciary, reduction of corruption. But it's also very, very important to promote. And I think that sometimes, you know, emerging markets don't not do enough to come out there and promote the good things that they have. And there, I think that you know, allowing probably some more foreign participation into some of these domestic markets is quite important. It's happening in the capital markets, but there are still some areas of the economies where foreign investors cannot come with all their technology, all the know-how to try to generate the necessary development. And then on when it comes to microfinance and all the sort of more development, more smaller type of products, I think there the roles of development banks and the public banks in the countries are crucial. But there you need, that is kind of like second stage. You first need to stabilize these economies, and in some places what you do, you have to create a funding to go for those kind of projects. I mean, deepening of financial markets is very, very important. Dissemination of information is extremely important. So creation of good databases for creditors are extremely important. But that takes time, and I think that in some countries are way more advanced than others. Chile is more advanced than other places, but that is the process that countries should take.
What I'd add to that is that when you look at the development of local capital markets, let's say that's something at the end, but to get there, you need to have all of these conditions we've talked about. You have to have financial standards, transparency standards, independent standards for governance, for oversight, boards of directors. You have to have an auditing system in the country. And I think it is a really high quality goal to have for countries to develop local capital markets, because of all the steps it takes along the way benefit not just the capital markets, but the entire society.
Thank you. We had another question in the back. Oh, go ahead.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am a global shaper from Tegucigalpa, Honduras. And since my country is a developing country, and we have really good foreign investments in the manufacturing sector, but I feel that we are not like growing or having foreign investments in an integrated way, my question would be like, what would you recommend to a developing country to grow with integrated economic growth? What would be your recommendation for a developing country?
If you allow me to just get one more question here, and yes, over there, so we can have, we only have less than 10 minutes. Who's next? Thank you. Over here in the center, and then we go there. Go ahead.
Hi, Duncan Wood from the Wilson Center. There was a brief discussion of corruption and Odebrecht earlier on, and many of us have celebrated the discoveries and the investigation. But there's a cautionary tale as well there. I think a lot of people across Latin America are looking at the Odebrecht scandal and Brazil in general and saying, we don't want to open up the Pandora's box because that's going to create an adverse investment climate, at least in the short to medium term. I'd be interested in hearing your reactions.
Thank you. Over here, please. Go ahead.
Thank you. Hello. My name is Andrea Costales. I'm from Quito, Ecuador, and I represent the Global Shapers. My question is, what is your point of view for the countries like mine when every year we see the government more as an obstacle for investment? What should we do as a private sector? What should we do as entrepreneurs? What should the private sector do when we have all the negative scenario coming from the government?
Thank you. Any more questions? Because I'm going to close it. So that, okay, one less here and we close the question session.
Hi, thanks. Vivian Liu from Singapore, one of the YGLs as well. My question is, what does Latin America think of, or what role would most in Latin America think of Asia playing in your economic development going forward? And in particular, Southeast Asia, not just North Asia.
Did you get it?
Yeah,
okay. Thank you. So we have 5 minutes. So whoever wants to start answering the questions, from the cautionary tale of the Odebrecht case to obstacle for investing governments being perceived as that. Go ahead, please.
Look, in the case of Honduras, as we all know, is one of the worst countries in Latin America. They have a very interesting thing that the Honduras Congress and the government approved, which was to create a zone kind of aligned with very much of what the special zones were developed in China, where you have special only security rules, different labor laws, etc. I think that today, the opportunity for a country like Honduras is to try to insert itself into the whole system of value chains that are part and parcel of NAFTA. And this means integrating itself better with Mexico. Why? Because Honduras will continue to be, at least for some time, a low-cost producer. And this can allow them to begin to integrate into areas that historically they haven't. If you look at the production capabilities that Honduras has today and its the type of exports that it does beyond pure commodities is largely around textile and apparel. But this can be broadened. And the way to broaden it, in my view, is to integrate itself more into clearly what can happen with the North American market, and for that matter, with the rest of Central America.
Who else? Yep.
I would take the question on Asia very briefly. Asia is a very rapidly growing region in many ways, not just from an economic growth, but also population. It is a consumer of the commodities which are produced in abundance in Latin America. I believe having the approach to trade agreements, the TPP, if that can continue as part of the way for Latin America to be closer to Asia, that's important. But I'd add another element, which is find some of the best models, and Singapore is one of the best models, where there's been an incredibly high savings rate, investment in infrastructure, investment in education, as well as a not corrupt public sector. The salaries that are paid to the central bank governor, to the minister of finance, are higher or as high as wages paid in the public sector. They've been able to build a system which is relatively free of corruption. And I would also look to countries like Singapore as examples of development models that have worked incredibly well.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Maybe on the question on integrated investments, what I do see is governments as well as companies, they work in silos. You talk to one minister talking about something, the next minister talking about something, not integrated enough in the government, not integrated enough within companies. So where I think we need to start in order to make integrated investments more effective and actually happening is governments and also private companies working together, but also within governments, within companies, within industries, to get away from the silo culture that we seem to like as human beings.
In the last minute, well, 2.5 minutes, but last minute, a cautionary tale that comes along with the Odebrecht case, how would you, Ricardo?
Well, I think we're a little bit like in the relationship between the region and drugs, that, you know, they were really just exporting them, they were not really part of us, so if you disrupt them, it will be violence, and so let's coexist with it. So a little bit the idea with Odebrecht is, you know, yeah, corruption, hanky-panky has always been there, so let's coexist with it. I think that this is a watershed event, and there's a before and there's an after, and we have to get to the after as quickly as possible, but we cannot assume that now we don't know that the way infrastructure has been built has been accompanied by massive corruption, by the way, probably Odebrecht would say, well, we were competitive on the bribing side, so it was sort of like a market equilibrium. So it is a practice that we somehow need to get hold of in a way that doesn't just stop investment, right? Stop infrastructure construction. But I think we have to face the reality and we have to get to the other side of the watershed event.
I think here technology has a big role to play, right? I mean, now you can make the bidding process very public. You can make the costs very public, and you can make the payments to companies that contract public works and the advancements of the projects very public, right? And so the technology can be of a lot of help to allow for that to happen. Now, that means that governments have to accept that they want to do that, and that has to do with the financing of politics as well. This goes two ways. I think Claudia was putting it very well. This requires more and more pressure by the people, right? And people want to know where the money is going. And what we saw in Brazil, what we saw last weekend in Argentina, is, I think, is a reflection of that.
And we've seen in Guatemala also, for example. We only have half a minute to say thank you for a dynamic conversation. And thank you also for being here this morning. I hope it's a productive meeting for you too. Have a good afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.